strategies to preserve your B12 or to make sure that your B12 is optimized. If you are, or really more specifically, who of you are at greatest risk for developing a vitamin B12 deficiency, even though you may have a diet or supplementation that's adequate in vitamin B12? And so some of the people that I see that come back highly vitamin B12 deficient are athletes. And that's mainly because the oxygen requirement of an athlete is much greater. So what we may have, athletes, when they're working out more and more aggressively, will stimulate their bone marrow to produce more red blood cells to carry more oxygen. But if they don't have adequate B12 to meet that need, or if their diet doesn't have adequate protein from an animal source to meet that need, then they can start to develop that deficiency a lot faster. So if you're an athlete and you're really struggling with low energy and lethargy, again, get back and ask your doc to run that test. Let's talk about some of the other tests I didn't mention yet on vitamin B12 deficiency. So MCH is a kind of a one marker that we can look at. There's another marker that helps us to understand vitamin B12 in a little bit better of a context, and that's the marker homocysteine. Homocysteine is a chemical byproduct of normal metabolism. Everybody has homocysteine, but if your homocysteine shoots up over 11, so if it's greater than 11, then you might have a vitamin B12 deficiency. Remember, vitamin B12 metabolizes homocysteine. It helps get rid of it. It helps to kind of metabolize it into another chemical called methionine. Then there's another one, MMA. Ask your doctor to run methylmalonic acid. This is a marker for potential vitamin B12 deficiency as well. But hands down, the best marker is an intracellular level. So ask your doctor to measure your intracellular vitamin B12 level if you really want to know about long-term deficiency, because the fact of the matter is the B12, most of it works, and when it does its job, it works inside the cell. It doesn't so much work in the serum. So if you measure the serum markers, then you could get a kind of a false or a misleading representation of whether or not your B12 is actually high or low. One of the other things that happens is your liver stores vitamin B12. And so your liver stores it for rainy days. So when your diet is low in B12, the liver can start punching the B12 from its storage into the bloodstream. That's called liver redistribution. So the liver redistributes its stored vitamin B12 when your body has a greater need for it. And if your doctor just so happens to be drawing your blood because you're tired and your liver is now redistributing that B12, you can get a far artificial normal level of vitamin B12 in the serum because of liver redistribution. So if we're talking about serum B12, it's it can be measured, and in some people it is that low where it does come back low, and you've got a big problem. If your serum B12 is low, you've got a major, major problem with B12 deficiency. But these other markers are much more accurate, and they're going to help your doc and help you to detect that vitamin B12 deficiency much, much sooner. So, all right, so that's kind of a fundamental crash course in vitamin B12 deficiencies, causes, foods, symptoms associated with it. Hey, and if you missed the earlier part of this series, click right here so you can go back and get caught up. The information there might be critical to helping you on your path to better health. And as always, thanks for tuning in. Make sure you subscribe for updates below. Have a great day.